Okay, our last chapter here that we have on linkage institutions that we're going to be looking at is on campaigns and elections. You see the little closed captioning that I have on there? This is what I wanted to try out today. And it doesn't work with Pear Deck, so that's why we're just going to try it without it.
I can't stop looking.
Yeah, it's like subtitles. You can't look away.
Okay, so campaigns and elections. What are some of the things that we're looking for in this lecture and chapter? How election campaigns are organized. Oh, I'm filming it. It's set up to record. Is it still in the screen? Jerrica?
Yeah, it is.
Yep, okay. We're looking for how candidates pursue office, how they set up their campaigns and structure it, and how they take advantage of things like fundraising and campaign spending, as well as advertising. We'll look at the types of other types of methods that they use. We'll look at elections, in particular presidential elections, but also congressional elections. And we'll talk about the results of the past three presidential ones. So let's jump in and begin with a little note here about elections in a democracy. Even though we are not the largest democracy by population in the world, which that country would be, anybody know? By population?
India.
It's India. Is the world's largest democracy. However, the United States conducts more elections than any other democracy or any other country in the world. And if you think about it, you know, we all know, of course, that we elect presidents and we elect members of Congress, but we elect people to state offices in 50 states. We elect people to over 87,000 different local offices. And when you add all of those things together, that's a lot of elections. Anyone that voted in this last election knows that we even put judges on the ballot. And they often run unopposed, but those are elections for those particular offices. There's even soil and water conservation districts that get elected within our country. So that gives lots of opportunity then for people to become more involved and to participate by running for elected office in our country. In our country, we have two different types of elections, and we have to think about them slightly differently. The first ones are what we call primary elections. These aren't the elections that most people think of when they think of an election. They think that the person that wins is going to become the next governor or president or mayor. In a primary election, that is where members within the same party compete against one another for the right to be their party's nominee in the second type of election, which are the general elections. But let's finish primaries here first. So what we mean here by primaries then is that within each party, there will be some sort of competition. There'll be maybe 2, maybe 10 different people that would like to be their party's nominee. So they have to convince their members of their party first that they deserve the right to be that party's representative in the next election against the other party's representative. So that involves a lot of different campaigning even within your own party. You want to make sure that your party members know who you are, so you start to build up that name recognition. You want to convince the people that participate in a primary, which is significantly less than turnout for a general election. In fact, it might be about 10% of eligible voters vote in a primary. But who do those 10% usually turn out to be? The most die-hard party supporters that they are. So if you want to win your party's nomination, which end of your party spectrum do you need to move towards the middle or towards the edge? You have to move to the edge, okay? Which creates a potential problem. Because in a general election, where do we find most of the voters that will participate in a general election? In the middle. So then you have to find a way to appease those that supported you on the edge with those that you want to potentially vote for you that are more in the middle. And if you say things that are too extreme in a primary, will those words come back to bite you in the general election with the more moderates? Okay, so that becomes kind of something that they have to consider. There are two basic types of primaries. First is called an open primary. This is a little bit more atypical, but this is the type that we have in Minnesota. In an open primary, anybody can participate. They don't have to be a declared party member in order to pick up a ballot and to vote in a primary. So you do have to, though, when you choose to vote in an open primary and you show up to the same exact polling place that you do in the general election, but you can only pick up one ballot. There'll be a Republican one and there'll be a Democratic one. If you pick up the Republican one, you can only choose between other Republican candidates. You can't say, well, I want a Republican for president, but a Democrat for Senate, and a Republican for U.S. House, and a Democrat for governor. Okay, you can only stick to that one party, which is okay, because when do you get the chance to be able to cross over between the different parties? In the general election, okay? Other states have what's called a closed primary. This is where only declared party members are allowed to participate. So if you haven't registered as a Democrat, you can't participate in the Democratic Party. And if you haven't registered as a Republican, you can't participate in the Republican primary. So there are advantages and disadvantages to both. An advantage of the open primary is that it allows for greater participation. More independent voters might show up and vote in an open primary, but the independent voters are prohibited from being able to vote in a closed primary because they're, by definition, they're independent and they don't belong to either party. Okay? But it can be good for a closed primary because then you only have the people that are genuinely, truly concerned about who their party's nominee is to be able to win. And you don't have to worry about the independents trying to select someone that you don't think best fits your party. Okay? So both have benefits, both have drawbacks. The other type of thing that's mentioned up here under primary elections are these things called caucuses. While not technically a primary, it's still something that a party uses to help determine who their candidates for future office will be. A caucus is a meeting of party members. They typically take place at the precinct level. In Minnesota, we use caucuses. But it's more just to get the party members in the same area to come together to meet, to talk about issues that they're concerned with, and then try to advance those issues up the party chain of command so that they can then become planks on the party's platform. They will also, during caucuses, discuss who they think their preferred candidates will be, and they conduct what's called a straw poll, which is just kind of like a non-binding, this is how I feel at this moment, who our candidate should be for whatever particular office. Okay, questions on primaries. Okay, then the more common election that we are much more familiar with are general elections, where the preferred candidate or the nominee from each party is going to square off against each other in the general election. This is the one that typically happens on the first Tuesday after the first Monday in November of election years. And so that's what just happened for us this past week. Okay. Now, the other thing to then note about general elections is that the winner of the general election then will get the office for which they are running. So we just elected a new governor in Minnesota, Tim Walz, who will now be sworn in January when he actually begins his term.